So for the next session, we have with us Dr. Suja Kartika, a multifaceted personality. It's a matter of personal pride for us to have Dr. Suja here because she is an alumnus of Cochin University of Science and Technology. For many of us present here, we know her as an artist who was active in the mainstream Malayalam movie industry during the first decade of 2000. In the second decade of 2000s, she was focusing more on building an academic profile, during which she got a PhD in management from Cochin University of Science and Technology. Right now, she is working as a lecturer in Hong Kong Metropolitan University. She is also a trained classical dancer, a trainer, and as I mentioned earlier, a multifaceted personality. And I'm sure in the session, she will have a lot of experiences to be shared both as an artist and also as an academician. So on behalf of Cochin University of Science and Technology's Department of Youth Welfare and Women's Studies Center, let me welcome Dr. Suja Kartika. Suja, the platform is all yours.
Hello, ma'am. Can you see me and hear me well?
Yeah, everything is working perfectly. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Okay. I know the profile of the participants here, and I was fortunate enough to listen to Priya ma'am for some time. I don't know how well I fit into the profile of a speaker in a gender conference, because I haven't studied it well, like maybe management or strategy that I am and have read over the years. But and hence, today, I would not, be sharing with you the realities of the theoretical perspective of things, because I don't think I'm an expert in it. I don't consider myself as an expert in it. I am not. I haven't studied sociology. I don't think I am qualified to talk about it. But what I am going to share today is some experiences of mine and some observations of mine as an artist when I was doing films in Malayalam and also some television serials, and also my experience as a dancer, as a Bharatanatyam dancer, and my observation as a teacher of young students and how they perceive social media, what influence social media has on them from a gender lens. So I think these are the three things that I will be talking to you about. And this is just a space where I'm going to share my personal observations and experiences with you. Okay. And in between, I think maybe just to break away from the monotony, we will maybe do some interaction activities or something like that, because you know that spark of being a trainer is somewhere there. So I feel that after about 15 minutes of talking, I want my audience to get engaged in some form or the other. Okay, so first I'll talk to you about my perception of how cinema has portrayed women. Personally, I have been categorized as the universal sister. Okay, so I have done about 25 movies, and I think about in 22 movies I was playing the sister role. It was a deliberate decision after my first movie as a leading actor that I did not want to continue in such roles, because there were a few things I was not personally comfortable portraying on screen and doing on screen. So I took a step back and took a very conservative, very easy way, but to be in movies also. I was very young. I was just all of 15. We didn't have, the technology. And hence, many decisions were wrong when I look back. Of course, they have given me experiences that I bank upon now. I don't regret them, but if given a chance, I would have made it better. Okay, so I have been the universal sister. And what does the universal sister do in all the movies that I have done? Whenever my brother comes, who's of course the hero, I would say, hey, Etan Manne. Okay, Etan Manne is like, how do you translate it? Oh, my brother has come. So that was one dialogue that I knew would be in the script for me. So I think that time when I was acting, most heroine characters, except for a few exceptions, were mostly dumb, dim-witted, or could be a damsel in distress, or sometimes non-skilled, sometimes semi-skilled. So the professional or the abilities of a woman and the exploration of that was very, very limited, I feel now looking back. There, I think the emotion was more explored of the female protagonist, may it be the main lead or may it be supporting characters like us. It was the emotional angle that was more, explored, and there was more portrayed. How far it was right now as a mature individual when I look back at it, and after so much of dialogue about it and being informed, now I feel that maybe that was not the right thing to be done, and maybe I could have taken a position of I didn't have so much of power. The power is very, very imbalanced. You didn't have a space to voice out what you felt like or what is right, because it is how it was. Now, I don't know if you will agree, but I have a very soft approach to this entire gang, entire thing, because I feel that, see, I'm going to now talk about my dance experience. Now I'm learning a classical dance item, and it is talking about a Nayika. Nayika is a heroine. And this Nayika is a Paragiya Nayika. What do you mean by a Paragiya Nayika? She already has a husband, okay? And she's sending him away for a journey, which would last a few days. She packs everything, sends him off, and then she gets ready herself for her hero, her original lover, which is perceived to be Krishnan. And she's getting ready, and he's refusing to come in. Krishnan comes, but Lord Krishna is unwilling to come in because he's scared whether the husband will come. So she's saying, no, it's okay, he won't come back. She's scared to, he's scared to come in, wondering if the in-laws will listen or will hear them. So she's telling him, don't worry, they can't hear, so don't worry, you come in. And I was having this conversation with my classical dance teacher. I was asking her, what are the kind of Nayikas we have? So Natya Shastra talks about 8 kinds of Nayikas. And all these Nayikas pivot around her affection, her lack of affection, her hatred, her how well she has subjugated her husband, everything around the lover. Okay. So her quality as a person, her temperament, all that has very, very, very minuscule role. It is her relationship with that man decides her character. And I found it very strange. And I don't know how many items I have done in my life, playing the Nayika waiting for Krishnan to come, or always saying complaints to him, saying that I was waiting there, why didn't you come? Or sending a sakhi to go call him and come. Now, when I think back, all the items that I have learned, it's something, there is that one person for whom this lady is waiting, or this Nayika is waiting. Now I wonder, so Natya Shastra was an ancient scripture. So I think then this was the reality. The role of woman then was how it was portrayed in art also. Okay. I'm not saying it is correct. I'm saying it was the reality then. That's my understanding. I have not read about all this. This is my understanding, my observation, and hence it can be absolutely wrong. Okay. But this is my observation. So the reality then, I think, was this, and hence it was translated into art. And art is one form of passing down of the culture. So the stories were retold and it passed on and it started being accepted as a norm. So that reflected in the television serials, in the movies. For example, I've been killed twice when I was an actor in two different characters. One, because my brother, because the villain thought that this girl if killed would avenge his son being killed. And I was, they killed me using a big iron rod. Another being that I'm from a, lower caste family. So this girl needs to be out of the picture and I was killed. Because now all those things doesn't make sense to me as an adult, as a grown-up adult with so much dialogue around us. We can say that it is the story and the story requires these portrayal, but how far it fits into the discourse on gender now, I don't know. But one thing is for sure, for centuries, changes may not have happened, but it takes only a few years for those changes to materialize. And I think for the past 5-6 years, we have seen this change to materialize. And I am talking from a very, very, very privileged position. Except for my character choices when I was an actor, which I look back and now maybe doubt whether I should have done them and things like that. But not even for a second in my life, I have felt inferior to the opposite gender. I have always felt that your gender does not define who you are. It is your ability, your attitude, most importantly, that defines who you are. So not even for a second, I have had an opportunity where I had to take a step back because I was a girl or I am a woman. I somehow feel it's in me, some things I can deal much, much better than, I know a few men are there in this discussion, but some things we can deal better. And then the strength that men have, certain things we may not possess. So it's that balance that is very critical and that's very important. And I feel all of us are educated. All of us have the access to the information to make an opinion on. You should give people the freedom to just be who they want to be. I think that is, that is how you liberate a person, isn't it? If you give a person, irrespective of the gender, to think the way the person wants to think and to act upon it, that is actual, that is how you liberate and empower a person. So if I was just listening to the earlier conversation about women bloggers and how they show cooking and some people show cleaning their bathrooms also. Some people, they're making money out of it. It is not easy technically to shoot these things. Okay, so it's not that they don't have any skill or they're just showing cooking. It takes an effort to place the camera right to ensure that a shadow does not fall into, onto the sub or the matter of what they're shooting. And editing is it's such a time consuming process. So there is a lot of technical skills that goes into making of a video. I agree. Content. Again, that is from the lens of the person who's watching, right? If you feel it is gender insensitive, or if you feel it's against stereotyping of content, that is from your lens or your perception. If another person doesn't feel that and enjoy the content, why not? See, it's that is what true. Giving space should be. But again, since I have not personally felt it, that does not mean it's not there. But at this, in this set of audience, I think all of us come from a privileged point where we can all talk about it. And some of us may have had slight experiences here and there, but by and large, I think all of us are mostly privileged. Now, talking about the social media and influencers. And here I would like to specifically talk about teenager influencers. Okay. So this is a very personal experience of mine. I want to share with all of you. Somebody in the family, a very close person, she's in the 10th grade. So her idols are all from Instagram. Okay. She wants to be as thin as them, the unattainable body standards that these people portray. Now I'm talking about women. The last part of the conversation of the previous presentation, the kind of expectations that are forced upon these young children, especially girls, it's unimaginable. And it's the hormones also during that time. You really don't understand what is happening to you. And you, there was a time when my father, when we were growing up, they're scared if, you know, I would have a romantic relationship. That was my father's worry when I was growing up, whether I would have a boyfriend. And my father's worry for my brother was whether he would, you know, whether there would be some substance abuse. That was his worry. I think it's the same for most parents because our hormones work that way, you know. But these days, the parents don't even have a clue of what is happening. So these unattainable beauty standards, a particular lifestyle that is acceptable, late night outs or, hanging out with friends. That is their life, I agree. I'm just maybe contradicting what I just said, that you should give people the freedom to do what they do. Unfortunately, we can accept it and judge what is right and wrong and take only what is right and leave the rest as just entertainment. Children of that age do not know how to make that distinction. And this girl who I'm talking about, she is actually an anxiety patient now. She is it saddens me when I say that her mother talks to me. She has mental health problems due to the influences that of social media and how, you know, women are portrayed. She has curly hair. She wants straight hair. She wants to wear a noodle strap top and a very, the kind of clothes that people portray. And the mother doesn't know what to do with her. And they've taken help from doctors and other things. And she just met with an accident where she fell off the terrace of a building. The saddest part is she had gone up to take a selfie of her. And a video, a reel that you play on Instagram. And she was going back, and then she fell down. I don't know where, as teachers, I think most of us are teachers. How do we influence our students to come out of this? I think that is the discussion I want to start here. I don't know if it is purely gender-based, but yes, I somehow have felt that more than for boys of that age, maybe it could be a video game that attracts them and they spend their valuable resource, which is time, on playing a PUBG or whatever nonsense that they play. But I think for girls, the level of influence that these influencers play on the girl students especially is a little alarming. So after coming to Hong Kong, that's what I see. I mean, no head is up. Everybody is on the phone all the time. And here two faculty members discuss the kind of influence that this media has and how children are not focusing on what is more important for them at this point of time. And especially they were all talking about more about girls and how they get more influenced by, maybe it could be the way we are engineered. We get attracted to such things maybe more than the men or whatever. Since I'm not an expert in it, I don't know the reason for it, but how can us as faculty members bring in some sensitivity into that? How can we educate them? How can we tell them to choose right and to tell them that this is not what the world is actually. Your career, your achievements after, you know, beyond social media is what life is all about. So the children are not, they're confused what, you know, what actually their achievement should be. Is it the number of likes, views, whatever they get on social media is what defines them. And I think, unfortunately, many female influencers have played a very, very devastating role in it. I have to say this. I have personally, you know, followed them for a few days to see what kind of projections are they giving out. And I had to unfollow them because it was so toxic. It was so toxic. You just couldn't bear it, you know, as an adult. So I can imagine the kind of trauma that a young person, especially a young girl, would be going through. I don't know if this is the correct place to discuss this, but since I started this discussion, I want to take some opinion from all of you. What do you, since this is a Department of Youth Welfare, maybe it's not the wrong place also. Do any of you have an opinion on this? And if yes, together, what can we do to, you know, bring in some sensitivity regarding this? Anybody, you can just, first of all, do you agree with what I said? If yes, yes, if no, no. Okay. You don't have an opinion or you disagree? Arati?
Hi. First of all, let me just congratulate you on a very honest and retrospective introduction to how you look back on your roles. Because honestly, it's a bit judgmental when I saw that you are the speaker because you are from the media industry. So I was like thinking, what would you say about the kind of films that were made? So as an individual, we look back and kind of reflect on our lives as well. Yeah. At that age, we had made some mistakes. And now when you think as an adult, it's different. Now coming to the influence thing. Actually, I am very new to Instagram. I just recently joined because one of my friends, I was kind of, I didn't want to join social media much because once I joined Facebook, I found it, I was addicted to it for some time and I lost time. So I just stopped it. And Instagram also, I found the same thing. Like, I have a teenage son. He's not on Instagram, but definitely this thing about video gaming is there. He was a voracious reader during his, till maybe around 10. But now he doesn't touch books, which is extremely sad to me. But what I found, I'm not a teacher for that matter. So I wouldn't know how to add to the conversation.
But you are another important stakeholder. You are a parent. That's even more important.
So I would like to present that perspective. What I found is like even as when he was like a child, like in his before maybe five and all that, I always used to sit with him and I knew all the cartoon characters and we always had conversations on how the characters were doing, all this Chota Bheem and all that. I've had friends who ask me, how can you tolerate at this age, you are sitting and watching cartoons? But that is how I connect with my son, like knowing what he's doing this. But as a teenager, I'm kind of finding it difficult to connect. But still, it is very important, I think, to know, like you said, you followed those Instagrammers to know what kind of content they are doing. But in many houses, what I have found is that the parents are completely disconnected. Like you also need to know like what is going on. You cannot just say that I am not there on Instagram. I don't like that. But you need to know like what is the kind of content that your kids are and what is the kind of influence that is going on. The conversation is very important. Let it be the parents or the teacher. It is very important. That is what I feel.
Yes, Parvati, I think the input you know, speaks volumes on it. See, conversation is extremely important and it ideally should start from home. And since they are spending maybe most of the day, they share it between the home and the institution in which they're studying. I think the institution also has a huge role in you know, creating this sensitivity. So I think I would like to get a feedback from one of the teachers also, what your opinion is regarding, or how can we at least make them understand, you know.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, I'm a teacher. Yeah. I'm teaching.
Hello, sir.
What actually happened is, as a teacher, if we try to correct these students, especially when they are doing something wrong, we don't get a support from the parents, right? That's a problem, right? When we say something to the, for example, suppose they drunk and come to the university campus, even the girls, not the boys, both boys and girls. And if we call the parents of the girls, what they are doing, saying that they don't do. And why you are telling like this to us? Because they are also supporting. So where should we draw the line? So we should give some sensitization to the parents. Especially when as a teacher, there are so many limitations for the teachers. If a teacher says something, next day onwards, the students will start agitation against the teacher. So they will try to stop everything. But if we get the support from the parents, we can do something, especially the PTAs are there, parent teacher associations are there. At that time, what we found is that certain parents are supporting us, but certain parents are just opposite. So we don't reach anywhere. So in an educational institution, as a teacher, it's very, very dangerous as well as very risky to have a tug of war with the parents, right? That's what I feel.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Unfortunately, the villain is something that is intangible. You know, the kind of, it's not the substance that we're talking about. We're talking about something that they see, that the perception happens in their mental state. They feel that this is the level of standard that I should reach, or, you know, their self-image is broken down into pieces. And this person, and the hormones are playing already havoc in their heads. It is that kind of an age. And with this kind of a social pressure put on them, which is sort of invisible, how can we help them is my thinking. And I'm sure as teachers, we should also be aware that this influence is coming from both genders on mediums like Instagram or Facebook. You know, I think that is quite important.
No, the thing is that one more incident, usually we don't allow the students to bring mobile phones inside the classroom. What happened in my class, one of the student's parent came outside. That parent wants to meet with the student. So what he done is, he sent a message to a student, and unfortunately, usually the students will not allowed to bring the mobile phone, but by somehow he managed to get inside. At that time, the message tone was hearing, and I asked him to stand up, and I asked him to give me the mobile phone. And I told that you just go home and I don't return it. But actually the parents told me that you don't have the right to do such things to the student. What should we do as a teacher?
Sir, I was just listening to you, and I was just evaluating the cultural differences that I as an individual is going through now. So here in Hong Kong, my son who's going to grade 4 has a phone with him. It is acceptable. It is allowed. It is just, you know, it is, So culturally, people exposed to maybe other cultures feel that it is okay because it is acceptable here.
Yeah.
Unlike India and Kerala and all that. So people who have had that exposure feels that, oh, how come? Yeah. All this is per people their perceptions, which is shaped by where they are, what they have experienced and all that, right? So now if I come back to India and if I have a similar situation, I might be that parent. I have given that phone for my son's safety or my daughter's safety. Well, what right do you have to snatch it from him? It could be. I will never ask that question, but it can be a thought in my head.
That question will not ask me a parent, because if he's a teacher, he don't do that. But there are only minor, only a very few people are parents or teachers.
Correct, yes, sir.
So majority are of a different culture, coming from different background.
Correct, yeah.
So as what I said is that teachers' point of view, we are really helpless.
My question is, how can we be not helpless? How can we together create something? I think Devi ma'am and Sangeeta ma'am, you guys, if you can take it up, just to make them not the threats of social media. I think that they all know. You know what. Not to be part of, or how they shouldn't fall into traps that come through social media. I think enough and more seminars regarding internet safety and things like that have been given to them. But how to not get emotionally frazzled by all what is going on?
Thing is,
I think, Suja, the aspect to be considered here is that for a fact, we cannot keep our kids away from social media. We have to accept that, because that's going to be the future, and it's already what's happening. So we can't do that. And I'm sure 5 years down the line, or maybe now itself, we are asking our students or kids to carry mobile phones with them.
Yeah, we are.
Yeah, so that part is gone. I'm sure once the kids are back in college or school after the lockdown, they are definitely going to have their mobile phones in there with them. So we so we cannot go back to the phase where we are telling them this is not allowed in hostel or this is not allowed in college. I think what is more important is, more than the teachers, I think the parents should start an open talk with their kids, especially regarding proper sex education.
That's
what
true.
Is meant by gender? What are the gender roles? What is expected in a gender? So all those kind of conversation, which normally doesn't happen in a Malayali household, I think that should become the norm. I think that's the first way to know your kid. Get to know your kid, make the kid feel that, okay, whatever is happening, whatever concerns I'm having, whatever havoc the hormones are playing with me, that's okay. I can always go and have a word with my parents, and they will have the answers to that. So that kind of trust should be there within the kid. Because I do remember the first time I saw the advertisement of a sanitary pad in the television commercial. I was 5 or 6. Mm-hmm. I asked my mom what it was. Of course, I didn't get a correct response. What I said was, this is something used instead of a diaper. That was not the proper response. But whereas my daughter, she clearly knows what it is.
Yes, we have more open dialogues with our children because we have a better perspective of how things are.
Yeah,
the dialogue happened as we grew up. No,
exactly.
I think it happened in the last 5-6 years where we were adults and now we can understand what things mean in the real sense. Yeah. Okay, so I think we have discussed a few things. Maybe how about initiating an activity? How many of you will be willing to participate? I know it is a little out of context, but why not? Okay. So if you are teachers, this is how your class responds to you. And you ask something, please turn on your camera. So let's do an activity. You get really, really, you'll feel bad. Okay. I can see faces now on my screen. First of all,
what is the activity, ma'am?
Come on. Don't worry, it will be very, very easy.
No, that's simple. Sir.
Okay, don't worry. Okay, come on, everybody. Let's just make it a little bit of fun. I know that is not what the intention of the session is, but doesn't do any harm to anybody. So it's okay. It's acceptable. I hope so. Devi ma'am, do I have your permission? Chair?
Yeah, definitely. Please go ahead.
Okay. So now I'm going to call out names because I cannot see your cameras being turned on. Divya Krishna, Dr. Vinita, Ervi, Nalja, Dr. Samira, Smita, Deepti, Shani, Dr. Shani, Jolsna, Nisha, Gautam, Deepti, your lordships. Okay. We need a few more cameras to be turned on. Come on. Hello, Divya.
Hey, ma'am.
Few more cameras. Come on. Let's do this. I know you are in your personal space and this might be a little bit of intrusion, but that's okay. I'm sure you will pardon me for it. Okay. So, so we are going to play a very, very, maybe so many people will start playing the game, and we are going to play a very simple game. Okay. And I need your hands free for it. your hands should be free for it. Maybe this is like a feel-up. After some time, we'll play one more game so that the rest of the participants also join. Okay. This is a game called Simon Says. It's a very silly game that small children play, but we can also play, no problem. Okay, the rules of the games are extremely simple. I'm going to tell you an activity and you have to do that activity only if I say Simon Says before the activity. For example, Simon Says, blink your eyes. So you should blink your eyes. Blink your eyes. Okay, very good. Okay. We'll just do a trial. So if I don't say Simon Says, you're not supposed to do it. Then you'll become out. Simple, no? Understood. We'll just do a trial. Simon Says, touch your nose. Simon Says, touch your cheek. Simon Says, touch your chin. Touch your forehead. Those who touched is out. Why? Because I did not say Simon Says. Simple game, no? Okay. Okay, so we are going to go into the finals of it. This was just a trial. Ready? Everybody, come on, let's do it. Okay? Oh, I can now see some more cameras turning on. Okay, yeah? Please come, all of you. Okay, so we are going to do the finals for it. Simon Says, blink your eyes. Simon Says, touch your ears. Simon Says, touch your head. Simon Says, clap your hand. Stop. All of you are out. Those who stopped, I think most of the people who come home, I can see on my screen, are out because Simon did not say to stop. Okay, I think Divya and Parvati, they were about to stop, but they controlled and continued to clap. Okay, so maybe we can declare both of you as winners. Okay, okay. So since all of you have turned on your cameras, let me ask you, to be very honest, at times, I have felt very overwhelmed with the kind of discussions that happen around us. And I feel always that people in privileged positions sit and discuss more about women empowerment than actual people who require that kind of empowerment or who are already empowered, you know, in their own rights. Okay, so I feel a little suffocated listening to such discussions, and I feel each of the kind of education that all of us have should enable us to make move ahead in life. Right? But of course, there is a marginalized section of the society being, you know, differentiated or targeted because of their gender. But what is your opinion? Just to understand, you can. Choose to speak in the language that you're comfortable in. I can understand Hindi, Tamil, and Malayalam. So, nobody wants to speak. Come on. Let's have a dialogue. Unnu maranille.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, hello, Divya.
Yeah. As you said, initially, like I've been teaching college students for almost 10 years now. Initially, I wasn't very much aware about my privilege. And you would tend to look at somebody who lacked a certain amount of awareness with, you know, you might be judgmental about people.
Yeah.
But, you know, as years went by, see, I understand my privileged position. Even like you, me, and all of us, yesterday we had a session where all of us were discussing light bulb moments where we recognized gender discrimination.
Yeah.
I think all of us have gone through that.
Yeah.
All of us. Some people might not be aware that we've gone through it and might have had a very late realization. So at present, when I teach students from a rural college where 80% of my class, I have girls in the class, where by the final year, usually about 10 years back when I joined, I would definitely have at least 3 pregnant girls in the class in the final year. That is, they are hardly 21 years old, hardly 21.
So,
see, Divya, I'm going to interrupt you here, and I just remembered another movie which I was part of, where my 10th standard classmate got pregnant, got married, and pregnant. I can't believe I did it. Okay. And fortunately, Meera got the National Award for the movie. So her career did well. Paada Munnuru Vilapam. So the place where we shot it was a rural area. And where we shot actually writing the exams, I was in 12th grade when I was doing that particular scene. So I was actually learning my subjects when I was sitting and writing those that scene and all that, I still remember. And this girl, there was a scene where I would go to her and tell her, say, I got admission in this particular college. And I was not, the character that I played was not a bright girl in it, but she was a bright girl. So she longingly looks at me with a heavy heart. She wants to tell me that I should have been in your position, but she was standing there with a pregnant belly. Oh my God. I can't believe I've... but such lives do exist, and cinema is a reflection of, like you said, three girls who were pregnant. So is it still a reality, Divya?
But like I'm teaching graduate students, even now, like I know on the last day of exam of the sixth semester exam and the very next day, many within a month's time, almost all of the girls get engaged. And in this particular locality, it is not any particular religious group, but it's everybody in general, this rural area. And if you are engaged very late, it is seen as something bad. Absolutely, for 25 is very good. So I tried, right at present, I try to understand my privilege, and I understand that their awareness or their lack of awareness, I should be able to understand that as well. Because that is the situation they're coming from. I cannot be judgmental about that.
Yeah, you can't be. Yeah. True. I mean, yeah. So how do you create awareness in such pockets? And, you know, right now I see that at least in India, because of some cultural, you know, again, because of our influences of our culture, some jobs have also been categorized that, you know, some jobs that only men should do, some jobs that should only be done by women. And I've been in this place for the past 6-7 months, and I absolutely don't see that discrimination here. Here I can see the huge, if the audience is, would excuse me, I don't know how to say this in English, but here, you know, road il auto undakana sadhanile veliya machine, the big drill holer, you know, to make the hole inside a tarred road. I can see women operating that. The metros here are automatic. The buses, the big double decker buses, are mostly you know, driven around by women. So jobs that we thought physically was impossible, or it was perceived to be impossible by women, are also being done by women here. And I've personally witnessed it. So I think it is an interplay of cultural factors and the perceptions that we have accumulated over the years. I think that's what has created this. But it's great that we are having these conversations. I can't imagine a gender discussion 5 years back or 6 years back or 10 years back having so much of audience, and you know, everybody has something to say on it now, because that is the level of awareness at least the educated community has. Like you said, not all are privileged, and even if they are educated, this sort of a wisdom comes from a little bit of experience gaining as well and seeing the world. It makes a difference. Okay. So I think only a few of us are left. Do you want to stop this, or do you want to play one last game and then say goodbye? By your smiles, I guess that is an okay for the last game. Is that okay? All right. Okay. So let's do this. Maybe just two. Okay. First, I'm going to make you do something with your hands. Your hands are free. You guys can switch on your cameras back, those who turned it on. Okay. So I'm going to show you four items. This is bread. Can you please show that repeat that with me. Bread, butter, jam, coffee. Show it back. Bread, butter, jam, coffee. Okay. Now I'm going to say this in various orders in various speeds. Ready? Okay. Show it to your camera. Okay. Show it to your camera. I'm so sorry. These are some of the ways that we can have some engagement in the online medium. Okay. So let's just do this. Play along. Okay. Ready? Bread. Butter. Jam. Coffee. Coffee. Butter. Bread. Jam. Jam. Coffee. Chalara bread and butter okay in very much.
The pan was very hot. That's why.
Okay, last. Okay. Bread. Butter. Jam. Coffee. Butter. Coffee. Jam. Bread. Butter. Very good. All of you did superbly well. So this is one game. If you are teachers, you can go make your students play it in their classes. So like I said, I'm not a sociologist. I was just an artist. I still am a dancer. And my perspective on gender is my experiences, my perceptions, and my understanding of what it is. It is not read. It is not steeped in theory as ideally it should be. It is all my thoughts. So these are my thoughts. If you are a faculty member, please do consider the emotional damage that social media and especially girl influencers have on girls that we teach. It is a reality. I have been a personal witness to it. So if we can do something about, making them aware of this, I think we should do. That is another responsibility as a faculty member to also ensure that their emotional state of mind is also very secure and they focus on what is more important than what should be considered as entertainment. Okay, so if I get a chance to come back into movies, I know what kind of roles I should choose now. Okay, and I'll tell you something. I had to say this at the beginning of the workshop, which I didn't. Let's talk about stereotypes. And I have been subjected to such a big stereotype. Ayyo, you are an actor. You got PhD in what? Mohiniyattam? Bharatanatyam? No, I tell them no in turnaround management. You study. Why? Because I'm a girl. Because I was an artist. Why? So yeah, the bulb light moment, maybe for me was that. But it has happened a lot of times. At first, when they see, oh, you're just an actor. And then, then you started talking, only we realized you can talk English. Whatever I have achieved. So the best way to answer such things is to just do and show. Like, no matter what your gender is, just to accept the challenge is to just show what you're capable of as a human being, not as a gender. Okay, so that's all from my side. I hope this was it was an honest conversation for me. I don't know whether that honesty is translated to you, but it was a very honest conversation from my side. Thank you so much for your interesting participation, for your smiling faces. Thank you so much for being so kind.
Yeah, thank you so much, Suja. I should say it was the most engaging session that we have had. And thanks to you, even we as organizers could see the faces of many of the participants. So we should thank you for that. Yeah, so I think we still have some time left. So in case if the audience have any questions to be asked to Suja, we can use the opportunity.
I'm here.
It's not a question, ma'am. Actually, in our university, we introduced gamification.
Okay. You're from Nual, sir?
Yeah, sure. True.
Okay. I guess that's actually okay.
And also, I'm alumni from CUSAT also.
Okay, sir. That's so good.
We introduced that gamification. So yes. That, I think that is given some, what the students should get rid of from stress. of complete
yes, yes. It will. Right. Yeah, it will. Because continuous listening, nobody can, sir. Even if you listen to it, you don't understand the essence of what is being said. So these breaks are welcome. So the next part of it, their understanding and their assimilation of knowledge would be more solid. So and mental also, breaks like yeah. this should
and
be.
And also for the teachers, one foreigner came to the university and he's talking about how we can teach with the help of dance, music, and also the stories.
So that's what I do, sir. That is my core area. Even, of training.
But the thing is that as an economics teacher, I was really wonder how can I make a story. But finally, I started telling stories to the students.
That is right. Exactly what my training is, sir. Yeah. I do so, training on theatrics.
The students are very much interested in listening that apart from the monotonous lecture given by the teachers. But they don't discuss, as you said now, what we are done here is that the majority of the students, they don't open their video.
Yeah.
They don't even discuss.
But so you should do some things like this to make them interested.
Yeah, that's it. That's why I said, yeah. When we send some stories and related to the topic, they all of them will participate.
So that is what, sir, because they are used to the social media, they are used to video content that is very engaging. And then how can we expect them to come and look at us for one hour and we are talking about very interesting economic theories and management theories.
Already they know more than that.
They don't, so we have to adapt as teachers. I am always thinking from the student's point of view. And I think we have to adapt as teachers and maybe think about innovative ways to capture their attention and retain it.
Yeah, true.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
May I, madam?
Yes.
The recent, I'm Dr. B.V. Ramna from the Department of English, Geetham University, Visakhapatnam.
Yes, ma'am.
The recent trend is that, earlier we used to ask students not to use phones, not to look at phones and all. So our leaders started asking us, because of this blended mode, they started, there's a kind of reformation we can think, as you were talking about, change in the mindset. Yeah, instead of asking them not to look into the phones, okay, let us engage them. Look into it. Assign a task.
Correct.
They'll have to browse. Anyway, they keep browsing. Anyway, they look into the phone. Instead of, being vigilant all through that who is looking into the phone and who is using the phone. Okay, let's give them a task and let's ask them, to browse the material or information, gather, and then a task can be given. That is what is being, done these days, by us. We have just started it. And many a time it works out, may not be always, because,
But we can try. We can try. These are the things we can try, and I think you should make those changes.
Yes.
We should also adapt, ma'am.
Yes, yes, obviously. Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Suja Kartika. Dr. Sani here.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, you are in the film field and everything. So what is your stand on WCC? So because we are talking about Women in Cinema Collective, so because we are in the film field and we are talking about gender.
Yeah.
So you're saying, if you get a chance, you are going back to film field, right? So what kind of role you are going to get it? So what kind of stand you are going to take it? And what is your stand on, or what is your position on WCC?
As an actor? As an actor, to be very honest, I haven't studied WCC the way I should stand and then make a decision on. I have fleetingly, heard and listened to their activities as a onlooker only. If I want to be a member of any organization, I need to understand what it stands for. And my perceptions and my value system should align with it. And I, as a person, should subscribe to the thoughts of the organization also. So I haven't studied WCC to that extent to make a comment on it presently. But since I don't intend to go back into movies, God, if I get an opportunity to go back to movies, then I will study about it. But now my opinion of WCC is very personal. And I think I would like to keep it at that. Yes, I hope I've answered your question. Anything else?
Okay, Suja, I would like to ask one question. Now, as a student, have you ever faced any gender insensitive comments from your teachers? Because as teachers, we have a tendency to glorify our profession, but this is something which we are, I think we don't pay much attention to. But as a student, I have actually faced those kind of instances. So I would like to hear from your perspective.
Again, ma'am, I have not faced, you know, that discrimination was not based on my gender. That discrimination was based on my past profession. Okay, the perception a member of the faculty team where I did my PG had was that, how can she be the first rank holder? Let's see. You know, you write my paper. Let me see. And till the first test, I was being addressed in a very insensitive fashion and all that, a little rude, to the brink of being a little rude. You can understand, no, when that negative energy is there. And I wrote my first test, and then he came back to class and he gave me 2 extra marks for superior case analysis. So that answer sheet, he still has saved with him. And he says, Suja, how wrong was I? So that discrimination was not based on the fact that I was a girl. That discrimination was based on the fact that I am an actor. I was an actor. So she should not have any sort of intelligence or ability for reasoning. It is that, and again, that is also a result of the kind of roles, the kind of, I listened to some of the interviews of my contemporaries back then, or my seniors, and I feel, oh my God, how naive can us be? But that was the kind of generation we were. The same people, if you talk to them now, they won't be so naive. We were all 15-year-olds, 16-year-olds, thrown into the limelight, fan mails coming, traveling all around the world, doing roles with the greats in Malayalam cinema. And then you, ayyo, enikku onnum arilla. You know, all of us would say that. But things have changed. So I think the discrimination came from my past profession. I think we should have an entire seminar on how artists are perceived by the general public.
I'm sure that would be another topic of discussion.
Please, I will be a vociferous person, a speaker there. I am going to come for that for sure.
Okay, so now let me do the role reversal. As a faculty, do you take any conscious effort from your end to make sure that you don't make any discrimination, or at least make sure that you are not being gender insensitive? And now that you are in a different culture, you are not culturally insensitive.
First of all, gender insensitivity. I am a very, very loud person when it comes to talking for what is right. And I don't care about what gender the person belongs to. So if I feel something is not right, I don't care what the gender of the person is. I would voice it out. So I would never want to do injustice to another person based on gender. Not consciously, never, but subconsciously, if it has happened, it should not happen. If you consciously, if you try, subconsciously, it should not come. But in case if that has happened, and if I have realized it, I have, I think one incident has happened, but it was not a sexist remark. It just came like we all grow up with these idioms that we are so used to know. And then when I went and apologized, my husband and me, we are classmates. Okay, so these are some of the reasons why I feel very empowered. So we are of the same age. He's just 8 months elder to me. So our careers are at the same place. I don't feel that he's somewhere above me. We are always equal. My brother and me has been treated equally always by my parents. So I have never gotten the opportunity to be gender insensitive. Cultural insensitivity, I am really scared to face my Chinese students now, because I have absolutely no idea of what the culture is. So I have Hong Kongers, I have students from South Korea, I have Indians, I have mainlanders, that is people from China, in my class. So I crack a lot of jokes that Indians understand, but I don't think those jokes will work, or the way I communicate might work with the other cultures. So I am in the process of understanding what their culture is, but I'm going to say that upfront in my class. I'm going to start my class in a couple of weeks that I am new to this culture. So if I make any culturally insensitive remark, kindly pardon my lack of knowledge for it. I think I should be upfront about it, but we have to make a conscious effort, ma'am. You can't just say whatever you want and just be all right with it. I think all of us need to do that. And all of us are doing also these days. It's not that we are not aware. All of us are doing it. Even my 9-year-old son says, you know, that's a very sexist remark. Don't say that if somebody says something like, you're a girl or you're a boy. It's just the person.
Okay, so thank you so much, Suja. So I think we have come to the end of the session. And as I said earlier, it was a very engaging session, most interactive session. So on behalf of Women's Studies Center CUSAT and Department of Youth Welfare, and on behalf of the entire CUSAT community, let me thank you and wish you all the very best for your career.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you for being a part of it. All the best to whatever you are doing. Your gender should not limit your thoughts, your abilities, and I'm sure it won't also. Okay. So let this dialogue be alive. Let's all participate in it, and may the best outcome come out of it as well. Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye. Have a nice night.
Thank you.